For the past 12 months, they've been something we can't leave home without, mask. But now with more people being vaccinated, some restrictions are relaxing. Here to talk with us about the new public health recommendations from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention is Dr. Brad Cutrell, an infectious disease expert here at UT Southwestern. Glad you're joining us. The CDC is now saying that if you've been vaccinated, you're able to do some activities. Dr. Cutrell, what are those activities?
The first thing we need to do is define what does fully vaccinated mean. So that means 2 weeks after you've received the second dose of one of the mRNA vaccines, the Pfizer or the Moderna vaccine, or 2 weeks after you receive the one-shot J&J vaccine. For those individuals, the CDC has released these guidelines, and there's more to come. The way I think about this is it's not like we're flipping a light switch, but it's kind of like a dimmer. We're starting to turn on the lights as we return back to normal. So a few key things that they're saying are safe for you to do is you can gather in a private or in your home setting with another group of individuals who are fully vaccinated without wearing a mask or practicing physical distancing. You can also be in around people who are unvaccinated, who are not at high risk if it's another household that you can be with them. And then the third important thing they say is that you no longer have to quarantine or test if you're asymptomatic following an exposure.
So if you're someone who's vaccinated, going to be with someone who's not vaccinated, what's the definition of someone who's at low risk?
Someone who's at low risk would be someone who is, you know, not of an older age, over the age of 65, or doesn't have one of those medical conditions that we've come to understand puts them at higher risk. These would be things like heart disease, obesity, diabetes. So anyone who has one of those high-risk medical conditions who's not yet vaccinated need to be more cautious around them.
So obviously what has driven these changes in the CDC recommendations is the number of people being vaccinated and the pace at which vaccinations are rolling out. There are now three vaccines, Pfizer, Moderna, and Johnson & Johnson. Tell us the difference.
So let's start with what's similar about them. So all these vaccines target the spike protein. None of them contain a live virus, so none of these vaccines can give you COVID. And all of them have proven very effective at preventing severe COVID-19 that would lead to hospitalization and death. And moreover, all of them met and far exceeded the FDA's requirements for safety and effectiveness for the vaccines. The mRNA vaccines, the Pfizer and the Moderna, are two-shot vaccines. They have some more strict cold storage requirements. And in the clinical studies, they were shown to be about 94 to 95% effective at preventing milder disease. And these were in trials that were done back in the fall. The J&J vaccine is a different vaccine completely. It's a what we call an adenovirus vector vaccine. It's a one-shot vaccine. Helpfully, it can be stored at a refrigerator temperature for a much longer period of time. So it's much easier to distribute. Now, in the clinical trials that were done in the winter, when we were kind of in the peak of the pandemic, that showed to be about 67% effective against milder infection. Now, I want to caution people to say it's difficult and probably unwise to compare the trials against one another. All of these are very effective vaccines that prevent against the most serious disease. And so we're really recommending that people get whichever vaccine that they're offered first.
And for people that are fully vaccinated, when should they still wear masks and focus on social distancing?
This is a good reminder to say, you know, now's not the time to throw away your mask or to forget minding your distance. So again, when you're out in public areas, when you're going to be in, you know, medium-sized to large group gatherings, or when you're in situations where multiple households with a mixture of people who are vaccinated and unvaccinated, that's really where we should continue to mask, continue to watch physical distancing until a larger percentage of the population gets their vaccine.
Dr. Cutrell, for people who are going to the hospital or to the doctor, should they expect anything different in terms of the procedures and policies in place about masking, social distancing, and those other interventions?
Right now in the healthcare settings, because of the fact that we know we take care of a vulnerable populations that may be at higher risk, we're continuing to practice masking and physical distancing and all of those same practices in the healthcare setting. I would say, though, that people who are fully vaccinated, this is a great time to engage in some of that important medical care or procedures that maybe was delayed due to COVID. This is really a great time to come and access healthcare for those other important needs.
This is spring break season for many families. Is it safe to travel?
I think if you are going to travel, you know, think about, is it safer to drive in a personal car versus you know, taking public transportation, I would still recommend that people avoid large gatherings, particularly indoors, when they travel. I also would just recommend people that if you travel internationally, you are going to be required to test before you come back. And it is still recommended that you have a 7-day quarantine after international travel, even if you're fully vaccinated.
What do you think about the amount of vaccine available now? And when do you think we'll have enough vaccine available for everyone to have one, regardless of their risk or medical conditions?
The latest estimates are that by the end of May, we will have enough vaccine for any adults in the U.S. that want to get the vaccine. So that's very encouraging news. Now, I think for older adolescents, say high school age kids, it may be the fall before we have both the data as well as the supply of vaccine to get them vaccinated. And for younger children, we really need to wait for the safety and effectiveness data in that group. And so likely would be the beginning of 2022 before we had vaccine for the younger children.
For people that have been waiting to get the vaccine, that are interested in getting it, what would you say to those about sort of what we know now versus what we knew a few months ago?
A number of studies from both hospitals and healthcare settings, as well as countries, for example, Israel, which was a very early adopter, have shown that these vaccines are very effective at preventing disease, really at the level that we saw in the clinical trials, which is very encouraging. And that's been our experience here at UT Southwestern as well. I think also there's increasing data showing that these vaccines are also about 75 to 80% effective at preventing asymptomatic infection as well, which is something that we didn't know for sure a few months ago from the clinical trials.
Dr. Cutrell, what do you say to people who are still worried, still hesitant to get the vaccine?
The first thing I do is I say, I understand, you know, these are new vaccines and people have lots of questions. But I say, you know, I've looked at the science as well as, you know, I've taken the vaccines myself. So I think these are our most effective tool of getting out of this pandemic. This is our path back to being able to gather with our loved ones, being able to get back to the things that we love to do. And so I really want to strongly encourage that everyone get answers to their questions, but ultimately take the vaccine if you get an opportunity.
Dr. Cutrell, I want to thank you for joining us today and for providing these important answers to these ever-evolving questions.
Thank you, Dr. Warner.
Thank you for joining us. Until next episode, stay safe and stay healthy.